Mohammad. I'm pursuing my MBA at IT Madras, and I'll be your host for this evening. On behalf of Department of Management Studies and Extramural Lectures Team of IT Madras, I welcome you all for this evening. I now take great pleasure in welcoming the dignitaries for the day, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, Director, IT Madras, Chief Guest Vikram Gandhi, and Professor T.J. Kamalanathan, Head, Department of Management Studies. I also extend my hearty welcome to distinguished members of the industry and academia, and my friends from the Institute. I request the guests to occupy the seats on the dais. I now request Sudarshan, co-member of the EML team, to welcome the guests. The ideal business is one that earns very high returns on capital and that keeps using lots of capital at those high returns. That becomes a compounding business. Warren Buffett. Finding compounding machines is hard, but once you find them, they all do the hard work for you year in and year out. That's why investing for long term in companies with sustainable competitive advantages builds wealth. On this note, I now request Professor T.J. Kamalanathan, Head, Department of Management Studies, IT Madras, to deliver the welcome address and share his thoughts.
Good evening. I'm very happy to welcome the Chief Guest, Vikram Gandhi, our Director, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, invitees, guests, faculty colleagues and students for today's function. It all started in 2009 as a pilot initiative, and we received
a rising welcome for this kind of a report activity from practitioners and policy makers. Today it has become an annual event. The department congratulates Dr. Thillai Rajan for his efforts in releasing this report every year. The report has also generated a lot of interest among our research scholars, and many of them would like to do research in this area. I would like to highlight a little bit on the Department of Management Studies and then also a little bit on today's report. We have a two-year full-time MBA program in the Department of Management Studies, and many students do specialize in areas like finance, HR, marketing, systems and IT and operations. In addition, we also have an MS and PhD program in the department. And in today's context, many students would like to take up finance as an area and specialize. So this particular report is definitely useful to many of them. In addition, I would also like to highlight more on the finance faculty, because this venture capital and private equity report, since it belongs to the area of finance, our faculty has done commendable work in this area, and they have been providing to the industry students who specialize in several areas in finance, like corporate finance and strategy, corporate evaluation, financial markets, computational finance, forecasting and time series modeling, stock and commodity derivatives, investment management, financial risk management, infrastructure finance, development finance and behavioral finance. So a lot of students who research in our department in the area of finance do look at some of these areas and they work on it. Apart from that, our faculty also are involved in developing some of the indices and models which are relevant to industry in today's context, like developing financial stress index, developing a corporate governance index for firms in India, developing a behavioral asset pricing model, and developing a financial risk governance model. So some of our faculty who are involved in this do also engaged in some of the research activities. Industry also looks for guidance, help and assistance from some of the faculty, and they are also involved in some of these industry specific life projects. And they do for HUDCO, they do for National Stock Exchange, and projects from ICSSR, for Nissan they do some work, T TCS, CTS, Ford Credit Global Analytics in Chennai, Goldman Sachs, etc. There are a lot of companies that they do for. So this is something which I thought would like to share about the department activities, and would like to, you know, comment on the work that the finance faculty are involved with the support of the students in the department. To highlight a little bit on the 2014 India Venture Capital and Private Equity report, this VCP has grown significantly in the last decade. There is an average annual VCP investment in various companies has around, say, $8 to $9 billion. So that's the amount that's happening in recent years. Reports on the Indian CP industry have largely focused on the VCP firms as well as companies or the entrepreneurs who have received these investments. There has been very little attention on capital providers to VCP firms. By focusing exclusively on capital providers, also called as limited partners, the 2014 report is an attempt to break new ground in understanding the preferences and investment patterns of the LPs. This report analyzes institutional LPs across several dimensions by their origin, whether it is domestic or foreign, by their orientation, whether it is private sector or public sector, or having a development focus, or by the type of business that they look for, whether it is insurance companies or pension funds, etc. This analysis is based on a large sample that has been collected and report has been prepared. The report also provides a perspective on the role of government in the LPs. In addition, a chapter looks at the increasing appetite of individual investors and family offices to invest in the VCP asset class. The report also compares international trends and practices and provides insights for policymakers to increase the capital sources for financing entrepreneurship. The results of the report would help both the VCP firms as well as the entrepreneurs in their fundraising process. So more about this will be highlighted by Thillai as he goes by. And I would like to once again take this opportunity to welcome one and all for this report release function. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I now invite Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, Director, Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, and Chief Guest, Mr. Vikram S. Gandhi, to release the report. I would request Director to make the presidential address now.
Very good evening to all of you, and on behalf of the Institute and all of you assembled here, let me express a most hearty welcome to our chief guest today, Mr. Vikram Gandhi. We are very grateful to him for having agreed to come and speak today on the occasion of the release of the sixth venture capital and private equity report of that is prepared by faculty and students of our management studies department. I'm also glad that the EML coordinators chose and decided to combine this this visit by Mr. Gandhi, which is for which we should be very grateful, because it's taken quite a bit of his time out to come here. Combine this with our EML series so that a larger cross-section of the student population and faculty here can benefit from his presence here. As Professor Kamal Navan mentioned, the VCP project, if one can call it that, has been going from strength to strength. I have been personally involved in the release function for the last, this is the fourth, I think. And I can see that for one thing, they have not slackened, they have not missed a year. And for another, the topic is different every time. And I have not yet had a chance to see the latest report, but whatever little I could understand by going over the previous reports, they seem to be well designed, well, you know, thoroughly done, and seem to address some new aspects every time. There is not a big tradition in this institute, in other departments, of releasing such reports. There's a lot of research that goes on. There's a lot of publishing in research journals, including from by the faculty of the Management Studies Department. Usually, those articles have to have something new, novel, something that's not been reported before. I presume reports of this kind focus more, are more in the nature of what we call tutorial articles in those journals. It gives you a very thorough picture of what is the state of the art, what's going on, what is known, and probably point out to some of the issues that are not that well understood too, but probably don't report any new findings as such. Though I don't know, some of these reports might include some new findings, but presumably I think it's more of a, in the nature of a good consolidation. We don't do that much in the other departments, but I think there's a case for that. Increasingly, I find that different parts of our society, government, public, even industry, community sometimes, they look for thorough reports, thorough compendia of what you might call broadly knowledge in different domains. They would like to know, for example, what is the current state, let's say, in the distribution and treatment of water and so on. We don't do too much of that. A lot of people here carry around this knowledge in their heads in a somewhat disorganized way, and if they are called to give expert advice or opinion, they do respond very well, but people don't see, there is no tradition of taking enough time and energy out to create these kind of reports. I think we ought to consider doing some of this. We can't do a lot of this because we are all completely distorted with our work, research and our teaching and so on, but some of this I think we ought to do. It has value that goes far beyond the amount of energy and time that we put in. So, in some sense, the Center for Technology and Policy that we created last year, which of course is supposed to break new ground, not just produce very well-researched reports, is doing some of this and will be doing some of this. But I think this could extend across the institute, and it could be done by several in several areas where we do have the ability, the people who understand very deeply what is going on as we speak in various domains. So I would like to congratulate today the faculty, Professor Tilarajan and others, as well as the students who have worked on this. And I hope the others who are reading the report will benefit from it and also understand how such reports could be done, as I said, in different areas. So I'd like to thank you all for coming here in such large numbers. I was just telling our speaker that it's a dicey affair organizing a lecture in IIT. You never know, which lecture will draw the students, which one won't. But I'm pleased to tell him today that he's got a full audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Gopal Srinivasan, the chairman of the editorial board of the report, cannot be with here us because he had a board meeting. This is what he has to say about the report. I congratulate Professor Tillarajan and IIT Madras on this very high report analyzing the capital providers of the venture capitalist and private equity funds in the country. I think this report very aptly takes forward the standards set by the 5 earlier reports published on the industry by IIT Madras. I found it not only very well researched and fact-based, but also rich in perspective gained through extensive interactions with industry practitioners and stakeholders. I'm sure it will be a very valuable reference for industry professionals and policymakers alike. Thank you very much for this wonderful body of work on the industry and for the industry. Entrepreneurship plays an important role in economic growth. For the entrepreneur, availability of capital to start his venture is of paramount importance. For the current generation of entrepreneurs, venture capital has emerged as a powerful source of capital. Venture firms not only provide capital, but also help the companies in which they have invested in several ways. Each of the past 5 reports in this series touch upon a very specific aspect of the venture capitalist industry. venture capitalist firms invest a lot of capital in Indian companies. Every year, the estimated private equity investments is of the order of about $10 billion, that is 60,000 crores. But who are the people who give capital to these venture capitalist firms? What are their preferences? How many have been their experience? How have been their experiences so far? These are the questions that this year's report tries to answer. I now request Dr. Tillai Rajan, Assistant Professor, Director of Department of Management Studies, IIT Madras, to give us the highlights of the report.
I'm eagerly waiting to listen to Mr. Vikram Gandhi, and I'm standing here between you and the next talk. So like the advertisement that comes in a YouTube video, I try and be as short as possible. And more importantly, I'll ensure that you know how much is left before the next speaker comes. So quickly, we have done five so far, but what I wanted to tell you was we've been extremely fortunate to have a support that increased every year. With each and every report, there have been more people who've joined hands with us, and in terms of contribution, in terms of suggesting the themes, in terms of reviewing, in terms of introductions to the right people, in terms of getting us connections to the relevant databases and whatnot. So it's been a wonderful journey so far, and we hope we'll be able to continue in the same way in going forward. So if I look at the India Venture Capital Report Series, we think it's different in two ways. I'm actually going to point out before I go to the main presentation. If you actually see this picture, I mean, in Tamil it is called as Tarambu. And the most nice thing about it is nobody uses this as a full flower, right? They take a petal out of it, and each and every petal is so fragrant that a single petal can be used to do a garland, right? So same is our approach. We don't look at the industry together. There are several reports that look at the industry as it is, but for various reasons, we said we will take a particular facet of the industry every year and look at it in as much detail as possible. The second is to get a big picture. So this is, let's say, a picture of daffodils by the lake. So each and every daffodil is beautiful, but then what filled Wordsworth's heart with pleasure was 10,000 daffodils all at once, right, dancing and tossing their heads in a sprightly dance. So we felt that big picture is better, big picture is good, and each and every report of it, what we do is actually looking at 6 to 7 year data, thousands of data points, which helps us to come out with some trends and evolution of the industry. So from this point onwards, I have five slides, right? So the number is there, so you know where I stand when I move on. The first point that I want to talk about is the landscape of institutional LPs. LPs are those who provide capital to the venture capital firms, and in turn, the venture capital firms gives it to several entrepreneurs. So limited partners can be classified into two categories. We have institutional limited partners, which are large organizations like banks, pension funds, insurance companies, and so on. And then you have non-institutional LPs, which we classify as family offices, high net worth individuals, and so on. So when we look at institutional LPs, what did we see? We see there is a large dominance of foreign investors. So as the exhibit indicate, in terms of commitments, both in the number of deals as well as the amount, there has been a large dominance of foreign investors. So Indian entrepreneurship as it stands today is predominantly funded, at least in terms of venture capital, by foreign funds. The second category that I wanted to show about is who are these LPs? By and large, they are what we called as asset managers or the fund of funds. So they contribute close to about 50% of the total capital among all the capital providers. So why is this important? It is important because most of the foreign funds actually have a global market to play. And they want to really look at opportunities all across the world. They don't want to really restrict. They don't have any special affinity to India unless until there is an attractive return that is provided. So in that sense, it can be very volatile. There is a lot of country sentiment that can actually be driving this investment. So today, there is a large realization that Indian entrepreneurship should also be funded with domestic capital, which is good. But then we found that there are three important things that the domestic capital can help. Point number one, domestic investors, as of now, they actually make average number of commitments higher as compared to foreign LPs, meaning that, you know, once we have a domestic LP that is convinced, then he actually tends to make commitments more often. He does not need repeated conviction. Point number two, commitments to venture funds. See, if you really look at funds across the different stages, where we have a serious problem is the ability to provide early stage capital, the ability to provide capital when the entrepreneur, is needing them most, when they are at the most volatile stage. So if you look at domestic LPs have been providing capital at a stage where the companies need them most. They actually make most of their commitment to venture funds as compared to foreign LPs. Point number three, most of the deals happen in those sectors that can have a very large relevance to the country as such. So if you look at IT and ITES has been significant export generator, significant employment generator for the country, and a substantial portion of domestic LP money has been made in deals in the IT and ITES sector. So that's the reason why we think domestic capital needs to pick up, and it can play a very important role in terms of strengthening entrepreneurship in this country. Slide number four. I titled this Missing Elephant. So if you really look at the comparison of India and the US and who are the capital providers to the VCPE firms, we actually divide it into four broad categories. I look at the sovereign wealth and the government funds, and then you have banks and financial institutions, and then you have the university endowments. We don't have very large universities that can contribute to private equity, but then we have the pension funds, which is a big difference. So if you really look at it, in the US, pension funds contribute about 50% of the funds that go to venture capital and private equity, whereas in India, you know, most of it is also coming from foreign pension funds. It's about 4.2%. So that's the missing elephant, right? So if you miss a pen, nobody notices it, but if an elephant is missing, then it attracts attention. So today we have pension funds, which are significantly large. See, for example, if you look at some of the largest pension funds, CalPERS in the US, $289 billion, has 13% allocation to private equity. CalSTRS, $189 billion, has an allocation of 12% to private equity. CPDQ Canada has asset of $176 billion, private equity allocation is 10%. Indian pension funds, size of $105 billion, private equity allocation is 0%. So that's a big missing void. There is a need to see if these funds can be brought in so that we can have a lot more capital available for entrepreneurship today. But then, why should we actually have pension funds? The reason is as follows. Pension funds provide capital at the late stage when the capital needed for entrepreneurs are substantially large. So if you really look at it, on an average, the VCP deal size is $10 million, but those deals where we have pension funds invested is $15 million. So it indicates they are funds which actually fund large deal size. And we also fund companies at the later stage. If you look at the company age, it's 12 years where we have pension funds, and the overall average is about 8 years. Finally, pension funds also helps in strengthening the primary capital markets. Companies that the pension funds have invested have largely exited in the primary markets as compared to the other investors. So 58.33% of the exit has actually happened through primary markets. So pension funds help to provide capital to late-stage enterprises, and they also help to strengthen the capital markets. Slide number three, entrepreneurship and the perils of the hidden hand. So entrepreneurship, if you call it, is like a public good. It has a lot of positive externalities. It spurs economic growth. But then, you know, it's too precious to be left to the hands of the free market economy, simply because Adam Smith called the free market, the hidden hand, as a natural force, right, that guides a free market capitalism by promoting competition for scarce resources. But in this case, if you really look at venture capital, private sector venture capital, what is the problem? The problem is there is limited amount of early stage funding. Most of it is going to late stage companies. There is a heavy skew towards technology. I mean, entrepreneurship is not just technology. It can happen in so many other sectors, but the way we see today in terms of venture capital is highly skewed towards technology. And then yet to spread beyond the metros, we still have large concentration in the metros, very short investment horizon, and limited risk appetite for innovation. Most of these are incremental innovation. We don't really have invention innovation. That's the feedback. So we need to really have the government steering, this government contribution, which can address some of the shortcomings of what we see of private sector venture capital. So government has actually contributed significantly so far in terms of setting up incubation centers that actually can provide, as Professor Les Ganesh of this institute called, provide love and nourishment for the entrepreneurs. And it's also needed to kickstart the venture capital industry. And the latest list reveals that there are about 50 financing initiatives by the government which actually support entrepreneurship. More importantly, government can play a very important role in terms of table setting, that is, provide a very conducive ecosystem for structuring the venture capital industry. So based on our analysis, we have about 40% of the funds that actually come into India is from the Indian public sector. So Indian public sector has been funding this, providing capital to venture investors in a very large scale. We just wish that it could continue and increase even further going forward. Last but one, there is a competition between trust and track record. So when we look at investors who provide capital, they look at two things. They want to actually, they won't actually be, shown element of trust. And then second, they look at the track record of the companies, of the GPs who actually they give capital to. But though both of them are important, one segment puts a dominant weight on trust. There is another segment which looks a dominant weight on track record. So as a proxy for trust, we look at institutional GPs, that is venture capital firms provided by large entities. For example, ICICI Venture is an institutional GP simply because it's actually promoted by ICICI Bank. Aditya Birla Private Equity, we call it as institutional GP because it's promoted by Aditya Birla Group. On the other hand, we have boutique GPs, which are actually started by entrepreneurs, founders of these entities who don't have any institutional backing. And they have nothing but rely on their track record. So if you look at foreign LP commitments, a large part of it is to boutique LPs. That means they place a premium on performance. But if you look at domestic LPs, you have substantial to institutional LPs. So that means they actually place a weight on trust. So you have two kind of categories of capital providers whom we feel having different priorities. It's also reflected in another form. So for example, we looked at LPs with least number of commitments and LPs with the most number of commitments. LPs with the least number of commitments are largely foreign, and LPs with the most commitments are largely domestic. So again, we actually see LPs with the most number of commitments, they are all looking at institutional GPs. So it's not the question of this or that, it's a question of both, but then we have some categories of GPs who are looking at trust, some categories of LPs who are looking at trust. There are some categories of LPs who want to look at track record. I think in the long run, we should probably see both of them parallel going on, each attracting GPs that they are targeting specifically. Slide number one, I leave a question, when will the ships be home? Right? Ships have to come home with their bounty, only then the investors can get their returns. Right? It's been historical that ships have been capsized mid-sea, ships get delayed, ships don't come home. We have seen it in Merchant of Venice, we have seen it before that, and we have seen it after that. Right? But like in the story of Merchant of Venice, when Shylock asks Antonio for his pound of flesh, either for return or for revenge, the VC investors cannot demand their bond be enforced simply because they are equity investors. So they are partners who get their gains if the ships come home, otherwise they get nothing. So what has been the track record so far? So if you really look at it, the track record has been fairly disappointing, as said by most of the capital providers. I am giving some statistics in terms of how much of returns have people got from different investments. So these are all investment level returns, not the fund level returns. If you look at a fund, there can be substantial number of failures, as it's seen in the traditional VCP industry. But if you look at individual investments, we are getting this kind of returns. But because of the failures at the fund level, we may have a substantial lower proportion of returns. And this is in terms of IRRs. We have rupee nominal returns at 18%. So if average return is 18%. And on an average, if you look at about 50% of the investments have to be written off, that's a track record in the venture capital investments. So what will be the fund level returns, right? It's going to be fairly less. So in terms of performance, it's not been very encouraging. So The capital providers have been disappointed. I am saying in their own words, they have been disappointed, they have been disillusioned, and they are not happy that the promised land have not been shown to them. So let's also look at the returns on different sectors. If you look at all of them, are the average is not more than 25-26%. The highest return is 26.47% in the telecom and media sector, but this is a sector that's actually not had many investment. We had lots of investment in IT and ITS, which is having a 23.76, but then we are having some serious lows here, 11.06 in manufacturing and 16.33 in consumer services and so on. So essentially going forward, what the capital providers are looking for is they want captains who can steer the ship faster, safer to the shores so that the gains can be shared. And with this, my last slide. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for presenting the highlights of the report. I would like to call upon Sudarshan Narayan, core member, Extramural Lectures team, to walk us through what the EML has seen this semester.
Okay, I really did not intend on doing this today, but this actually might be the last EML of the semester. I did promise you we'd get Dr. Radhakrishnan, the chairman of ISRO, this semester, but yeah, we're trying, but for all you know, he might not turn up this semester. We're still trying, so we'll let you know. Anyway, so very quickly, quick run through what happened this semester. When Hari and I, my co-core, we were sitting down and discussing how we take this year through. It was at that point of time that we had the annual budget release. So we thought, why don't we go ahead, do something really quick and that would also benefit the students. So we had the first ever panel discussion in the third year history of EML. So we had a budget discussion which involved Mr. T.T. Srinivasa Raghavan, Professor Lakshmi Kumar, Sri Prakash Damodaran and V. Murli. So they debated for an hour about whether the budget was a damn squib or was a game changer. The semester began and so did EML, very emphatically in fact. We had a very grand inauguration by Sri ESL Narasimhan, the governor of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, who spoke to us on what he saw were the challenges ahead in Indian administration. Madras, Nalla Madras. We did listen to this song, this very iconic song where Nagesh walks us through how Madras looked about 50 years back. It was to coincide with the Madras Day. We had Pradeep Chakravarti give us 3 short stories, 7 facts, and 5 important mindsets that would help us live through this city. August 28th, Gautam Vasudev Menon walked us through life, films, and everything in between. In September, we went on to do something a little more traditional, a little more subtle. We had Dr. Padma Subramaniam show us her world-acclaimed dancing skills. She did go a step further, even sang a song for us. I think that has become a tradition this year because even Gautam Menon sang a couple of songs for us, Padma Subramaniam sang a song for us. Then, September 25th, big day, it was termed epic mural lecture by somebody who tweeted. Ramesh Srivats took us through half an hour and, you know, made us literally roll on the floor laughing with his trademark wit and humor. Good things also come in small packages. We also had a smaller series of lectures termed EML minis, where we wanting to do a set of lectures concentrated on a particular topic and which witnessed crowds of not more than 100 people. We had Mr. R. Ramachandran, the former chairman and managing director of Andhra Bank, who spoke on the economics of India on a lecture titled Are We at the Turning Point? Then we had Mr. S. Muthaya, a celebrated columnist who writes the Madras Miscellany, who's been doing that for the last 10 years in the Hindu. He took us through heritage and what it meant and how we can preserve it. Another first this year was a lecture demonstration by Kalaimamani Dr. Sundar, who brought Avina, Amridangam and 3 of his students. We ended up having an hour and a half of lectures and a lot of music and how it entwined all these years. Promise you more next semester and hopefully we'll have Dr. Radhakrishnan this semester itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Sudarshan, and congratulations to the team EML for a successful journey so far. It is my privilege now to introduce today's chief guest. He qualified as a CA before graduating from the Harvard Business School as a Baker Scholar. Subsequently, he became the country head and president of Morgan Stanley India. Later, he was a co-head of Global FIG at Morgan Stanley in New York. Subsequently, he was the vice president of the investment banking and global head of finance institutions business for Credit Suisse in New York and Hong Kong. He was a member of Credit Suisse Global Investment Banking Management Committee and the Fixed Income Operating Committee. During his 23-year career in investment banking, he has focused on advising board of directors and CEOs around the globe on strategic direction and the implementation of major mergers, acquisitions, and capital raising initiatives. He is the founder and CEO of VSG Capital Advisors. The firm focuses on strategic, financial, and investment advisory services, both in the private and social sectors. VSG Capital Advisors has been retained by the Canadian Pension Plan Investment Board, one of the largest pension funds in the world, with assets close to about $200 billion, as senior advisors to provide strategic advice and develop and facilitate investment opportunities in the Indian subcontinent. He has been involved with various developmental activities in India and globally. He is a board member and chairman of Asian Regional Committee of Grameen Foundation, a board member of Janalakshmi Financial Services, and a member of Investment Committee of Gawa Capital. He is a founding member of Harvard University's South Asia Initiative. He is a member of the Global Leaders Circle and associated with Social Entrepreneurship Initiative at Harvard Business School. Additionally, he has worked with the National Innovation Council over the last few years to set up the Indian Inclusive Innovation Fund. He is also a member of the Standing Council of Experts under the Ministry of Finance, Government of India. He divides his time between the major financial centers of the globe, New York, New Delhi, Hong Kong, and London. Distinguished guests and friends, the keynote address and the extramural lecture by our chief guest, Sri Vikram S. Gandhi.
Thank you so very much. I'm really privileged to be here, and thank you for that introduction. I didn't really need to go through all that, but I appreciate it. First of all, thank you very much for having me here. I really appreciate it, Professor Ramamurthy, Professor Kamalanabhan, Professor Rajan Thillai. It's indeed an honor to be here, and congratulations to the EML for all the great lectures you've had. You know, when I was actually in college and I was quite involved with organizing things like this, I knew there was one way to fill a room. I do appreciate you all coming. But the way to fill the room was actually to offer beer and food. And you'd have like house full with waiting lines. So I don't know if that exists in IIT or not, but it definitely did where I grew up. What I wanted to discuss with you today, and I wanted to give a more of a practical perspective, I haven't been to the IIT Madras campus before, and been here in the last few hours and really seen some wonderful different projects that are going on, excellent discussions with the professor group here. And obviously this is like the hotbed of intellectual and intellectual capital. But what I wanted to give you today was more of a practical perspective, if you will. Having now spent time, as was said, in different parts of the world representing different financial services companies, and now actually working a lot with large pension plans, a lot of whom have invested in venture capital over the years, that to give you a practical perspective as to how they look at investments, but equally, how are they looking at India? I mean, as the title of which Professor Thillai Rajan and I had discussed, was to give a perspective of investing in India, both from what I would call a Wall Street perspective, which is the trading, the FIIs, the FPIs, et cetera, but also from a mainstream perspective, which is really foreign direct investment, if you will. And they do different kind of mindsets, but quite similar in terms of how they potentially look at a place of investing in India. And a little bit while we are sitting in India and we get caught up in this thing about, you know, big economy, high growth, big population, I think it's a good to kind of step back and actually think about how people are actually looking at India. And in that context, I do want to congratulate you on some of the reports I've seen before. I haven't really fully read your this report, but it's a very, very relevant relevant topic that you've chosen, because for the entrepreneurial activity in India to really develop, you really do need long-term capital, and how to garner that both domestically and internationally is critical. I mean, particularly, for example, when I talk to international investors, and to your point, Professor Thillarajan, you know, the Indian domestic investors don't invest in venture capital and private equity, and maybe for regulatory reasons. And so the first question you get from international investors, well, if they're not investing, why should we? So it's one of those things where you really do need to develop the local institutions to focus on this. I have a bunch of slides, and I'm going to really use those as just as talking points and kind of breeze through them. And then I did want to leave as much time as you'd like me to for question and answers and discussions at the end of it. So if I just step back, like I said, looking at foreign investment, the Wall Street perspective, and I'm going to focus on how foreign investment looks at India, if you will. There clearly are, broadly speaking, two buckets. There's the foreign portfolio investment, like they renamed it recently, which are the FIIs, as well as the ADRs, et cetera, that exist around the world, which is another way of getting exposure to the Indian market. And then there's the Main Street, the foreign direct investment, which is basically either investing directly in companies, joint ventures, 100% subsidiaries, or whatever. Why is foreign investment important? Clearly, if you look at the growth trajectory of India and the capital actually required in India and the savings rate that India kind of is projected to have, the capital formation in this country, regardless of how you look at it and cut at it, is not enough to fund the growth. And so you really do need some form of foreign capital to supplement domestic capital formation. You know, transfer of technology, best practices, job creation, financing of the current account deficit, which became a big issue last year at this time. If you recall, the rupee was a bit of a free fall, or maybe a little last summer. So to supplement that, and then it clearly creates competition in the domestic market, which is beneficial, I think, in the longer term. It clearly gets some resistance at times, but definitely beneficial in the long term. What are the limitations? Clearly, portfolio investment, as was mentioned in the speech earlier, is somewhat fickle. I mean, it goes where the flows go. As you saw again last year at the summertime, when there was some speculation that the Fed in the U.S. was going to start reducing its easing, people started selling emerging market stocks, bonds, and moving back to the dollar because they felt the dollar yields were going to pick up, and therefore the relative return was not there. Clearly, it is much more fickle than one would like, particularly on the FII side, FPI side. There are a lot of high-priority areas in India, and you will find that most foreign investors will focus more on the high-profit areas, which is as they should over a period of time. You can have foreign interests which are at odds with domestic interests and business interests and political interests, and they can be politically potentially disruptive to a domestic industries. Though I think in the longer term, as has been seen with a lot of industries in India, you know, mobile communications being one of them, banking being another in terms of domestic competition. Opening up industries actually in the long term is very, very beneficial to consumers, and I strongly believe that. So then you step back and say, just let's look at India in the global context. India's stock market today is basically 2% of the market globally, all right? So while, again, it is a growth, it's an important economy, it's essentially 1.2 trillion is the market cap compared to, say, 55 trillion of the world. The other thing is, however, the flip side of that is the markets are just not as developed and as deep. And that, as was mentioned before, I'm spending quite a bit of time with different people in the Ministry of Finance and RBI to really kind of create more depth and how to go about creating more depth in the financial markets in India. And as a result, if you see in places like the UK and the USA, market cap as a percent of GDP is significantly higher than a place like India or China. And I think that shows that there is not only as a result of GDP growth, but the size of the markets relative to the size of the economy, there is an enormous potential for growth in the markets here. Then you look at, so that was the markets, and you look at the gross domestic product of India. It's essentially 3% of the world today. If you look at it in current US dollars, and the other side, if you look at it in purchasing power parity, it's 7%. So while, again, in the context of an international investor sitting in California or New York or London or somewhere, in the big scheme of things, as they're looking at capital allocation, India is a very, very small part of the equation right now. And what are the key issues that they see? So the first step in any investment analysis, whether it be for foreign portfolio investment or for FDI, the first, which I'm going to spend the next few minutes on, the first analysis, before you get into any specific fund you're going to invest in or company or industry, the first thing is to step back and look at what is the macro picture. What is the macro picture of that economy, and therefore, is that macro picture of that economy attractive for long-term investment? So what are the challenges as they look at India's economy? Essentially for the last 2 years, investment in India, capital formation in India has come to a standstill. And really the investment climate has just fallen off a curve. Now clearly I'll get to it in the end. The sentiment in the last 3-4 months has improved a lot. But if you just look at the last few years, there's really been, you know, a fall off in investment. The other thing which they need to do, like I said before, is get foreign investment to supplement domestic investment, developing infrastructure, and developing soft infrastructure as well. People talk a lot about the roads and ports and everything else, but actually the soft infrastructure, which is such a critical part of what IIT is all about, in terms of human capital, for example, is a critical piece of infrastructure development going forward. So when you talk about key issues, if you look in the last few years, which is the dotted line, savings as a percent of GDP, gross capital formation as a percent of GDP, in the last 2-3 years, it has really gone down dramatically. I'm just giving you a snapshot of how foreign investors look at the macroeconomic picture of India. Then you look at what I would call the importance of investment. And I think if you look at the macro picture, this probably one of the most important and telling slides that I perhaps could show you today. There are 110 million jobs given like young people like you who are going to go in the job workforce. There are 110 million new jobs that need to be created in the next 10 years in India. That is more than most of the next 50 countries combined. And so if you look at the potential job creation that needs to happen in Brazil, the US, et cetera, I mean, it's just a staggering chart. And so if you step back and say that 10 million jobs roughly need to be created in India every year, that is a monumental task, both in terms of being a potential challenge, but at the same time being a huge, huge growth opportunity. The next key issue is real GDP growth. As you can see, again, in the last 3-4 years, the real GDP growth has dramatically declined. Employment growth is basically at a standstill. It's really not increased. And if you've got to create 10 million new jobs, then the country really needs to be doing something dramatically to actually change that curve. And again, I think as this government and even the previous government has talked about, it's a matter of putting in implementation. Services, IT, et cetera, are important, but my understanding in the big scheme of things is, you know, the entire IT services industry, including all the peripheral, basically create about 20 to 25 million jobs. You have to have a robust manufacturing and infrastructure sector to really create jobs of the magnitude that we're talking about. So this was the infrastructure need. If you look at the bottom part, which is the top part, which is the lighter shade, the projected gap, everyone kind of knows this, but the projected gap in infrastructure for the next 5 to 10 years is dramatic. Inflation. Inflation is unsustainably high, and I link this right now to the cost of capital. The cost of capital right now in India is too high, but again, this is the other part of the picture, in the macro picture, which is inflation, which was under control for the first half of this last decade, and then in the last 4-5 years is again kind of spiraled out of control. The twin deficits, the fixed income investment. As a result of all those things, fixed income, as you can see, the fixed investment in the last year or two has really been zero in terms of growth. That cannot be sustainable if you've got to create 10 million jobs a year in the country. The twin deficits, the current account deficit, now it's come back a lot because they've put imports on gold, there's been more FII flows, etc. But if you can again look at the trajectory in the last 5-6 years, the twin deficits have been enormous. And this one being the current account deficit, which really caused a lot of pressure on the rupee, as you're aware. The fiscal deficit too, which I think is even a bigger fundamental issue, is that, you know, if you have a fiscal deficit north of 4-4.5% of your GDP, you will not be able to create the kind of capital formation that you need for growth in this country. And therefore, creating more efficiency in the government system, reducing and creating a better tax net. I mean, the tax inefficiency of the system right now is quite staggering, actually. But, so if you step back, and as a foreign investor, looking at all that, you'd kind of run for the hills. I mean, India will not be part of your investment portfolio. So the question really is there a turnaround, but what is the story? And ultimately, everyone knows the consumer is the overriding positive in India. I mean, the 10 million jobs or young people coming into the workforce and the moving and migration of people from different classes of society to increase their purchasing power, that is by far the single reason why investors, whether it be FII, FDI, et cetera, look at India, even though it's a small part of the world, look at India in a very serious manner, if you will. And this just gives you an example of personal consumption, just one example of a household, you know, personal care products, you know, expected to increase by 11.5% per year for the next 10 years or so. So that's just one example, and you can see that in terms of how the stock markets, in terms of the consumer staples, et cetera, have done. So that's the kind of overriding positive why investors are looking at India. So let's then turn to the FII, the Wall Street part, to see how it does foreign portfolio investment in India compared to, say, some of the other countries, and how has it changed over a period of time. The chart, the India is the blue line right now, which is, you know, it's about $20 billion at the end of so 2013. Again, it's large, but, you know, there are many countries that are larger than India. And again, in the last couple of years, it declined. It has come back a little bit. But it's stabilizing. Having said that, in the last 9 months, it has dramatically increased. The FII flows in India this last 9 months, and I think to a large extent, as I said, it's the sentiment that has created this over a period of time, is the FII stake rose to record levels of 25% of the top 75 companies. And now, you know, there are limits on how much the FIIs can hold, both in terms of free float and different regulatory limits. But right now, FIIs are holding about $345 billion of Indian equities, and they own 75% of what they can actually own. And you can see that in the bottom chart as to how the total top 5%, the ownership, has increased dramatically here in the past few years, but particularly in the last 9 months. Debt is another one. I mean, we talk not a lot about FIIs, but actually foreign debt investment in India is a big part of the story as to how foreign investors are looking at India. This year, the $128 billion of debt is by far the largest it's ever been. And this was from a big reversal last year. The reversal happened last year, as I was saying, over the summertime, when you know, there was fear that the, not fear, but there was an inclination that the easing in the US would stop. So people were doing what you call a carry trade. I don't know if they're familiar what a carry trade is. It's kind of a risky trade, but people do it all the time. Basically, you borrow in dollars at 1%, you invest in rupees at 11%, you take the currency risk and hope for the best, I guess. And that has actually paid off in some cases, and in some cases it's been a disaster. But this carry trade is the way, you know, a lot of the hedge funds, a lot of the private equity firms actually do this, is a way to supplement their core income. And that's been attracting a lot of flows into India, because if you can earn, say, 9-10% in government debt, which is from a credit perspective perhaps risk-free, relatively speaking, but from a yield perspective is dramatically high, and you can do it for a certain period of time, you know, the carry that you can make on that, and you leverage that up, the carry and the returns you can make on that are quite dramatic. Then we come to private equity, which is obviously a topic of a lot of the this report and previous year's reports. India private equity is very low, you know, with an average of 9 billion, as was said, 9 to 10 billion. Now, while in absolute terms that seems a large number, in the big scheme of things, you know, 10 billion is a size of a fund raised by a large PE firm on average. So, you know, while there has been large, the actual private equity flows by foreign equity and foreign investors to India, for example, is just about 3% of all private equity deals happen in India. So on the one hand, it's a small proportion. On the other hand, there is actually big, big scope for improvement. I'll stop here for a second just to tell you how investors look at private equity. Ultimately, an investor looks at private equity by saying, what is the incremental return I can get in private equity investment over what I could get in the public markets? That's one way of looking at it. You know, the public markets are liquid. If a public market is going to deliver, say, 15% per year, typically you'll find that private equity investors would like to get at least 5 to 8% on average return above that, for compensating for the potentially the higher risk, compensating for liquidity, you know, or lack thereof. And so that's what you typically expect. I think you all have done a lot of research on this, but in terms of, if you look at how private equity returns have actually done in India, they come nowhere close to that kind of return over the public markets, partly because private equity has not made some very good investments or the timing was wrong, but partly also the Indian stock market actually has done pretty well. So in fact, a lot of private equity players in India don't really do private equity. They actually buy 5% of a public traded company and go in and out of that company, the pipes. And a lot of the return actually has been done in that way rather than true private equity, if you will. So the deal value in India has risen, though. As you can see, on the left side, the emerging PE deal value in India is the middle piece. It has gone up, but it's skewed by one or two large deals. The number of deals also has gone up. But again, if you compare it to a place like China, both in terms of number of deals as well as size, it's still very small. Partly, again, because the opportunities to find good PE investments is not there. A lot of ownership is concentrated in promoters. They don't like to give up control. The PSUs are not going to get privatized anytime soon. And so there's, on the one hand, you can talk about returns, but there's also not a lot of what I would say available or investable capital, investable opportunities that would lend themselves to the kind of private equity that we see elsewhere in the world. Switching gears quickly to a foreign direct investment. Now, India's FDI, and this is by what this means is, you know, buying companies over here and or investing in joint ventures or setting up 100% subsidiaries. India's FDI flow has been between 23 and 36 billion. India is the one at the bottom there, the blue pit. Having said that, at that same period of time, if you look at this 5-year time period, you know, China's FDI, while on an absolute basis anyway being much larger, has basically doubled. Brazil's has tripled, and Indonesia's has quadrupled. So Indonesia, you know, whose economy is probably 20-25% the size of India's, the FDI piece is not that much less than what India sees. The point being that India needs foreign capital, and it's not getting it. And there may be a lot of reasons why, but there is still a big gap between what is needed and what is actually happening. If you look at FDI flows globally, where unlike in China and Brazil, where FDI as a percentage of GDP is nearly 3.5%, in India it is only 1.5%. And there too, again, as you look at, you know, on a relative basis, I've just taken China, Brazil, Indonesia as three benchmarks. In all three of them, it is dramatically smaller compared to the size of the economy. So something is not happening right here. And part of it has to do with policy, and I'll get into that. Now, the new government, as you've seen, and even partly the old government, understands the importance of foreign direct investment. We've taken a lot of reforms in the last 6 months, at least talked about them and implemented some of them, whether it be in insurance, in railway infrastructure, which, as you all know, is badly needed, and in defense, and all three interesting areas. Getting, as you know, the Prime Minister has been on this global roadshow, and between Japan, China, and the US, you know, have got over $100 billion of commitments. Now, how that actually translates into real investment, we'll have to see over a period of time. And the whole issue of Make in India, which is ultimately, if India is to be a global manufacturing hub, and around Chennai actually is an interesting case study of, you know, the automobile industry and people talking about this being the new Detroit of the world. Is to see how that really materializes in actually bringing serious amounts of money into the country. What are investors saying? Having looked at all this entire picture, what are investors saying, both particularly from a foreign direct investment perspective? You know, in my previous role at Morgan Stanley and Credit Suisse, I advised a lot of companies looking to invest in, not just in India, but Asia, from a strategic perspective. And again, if you look at relative to other markets, when they look at, if I'm a multinational sitting somewhere, as I said, in the US, you know, India is one country I can invest in. I can invest in Brazil, I can invest in China, I can invest in the US, I can invest in Canada, wherever. So then if you step back and look at the returns that people have seen, they really have not been as attractive as some of the other markets. Everyone talks about this whole issue of continuity, stability, and predictability of policy. And that's a critical factor. I mean, you think about it. You're a multinational, you know, 2% of your sales comes from India, and 80% of your headache comes from India. Why would you bother, right? So it's like, it's a very important thing way to, you have to think about how people are looking at it. The cost of capital is extremely high. Now, if inflation rates are where they are, and government borrowing is 8-9%, let me tell you how a foreign investor looks at what kind of return is required in India. So you look at 8-9%, which would be the so-called risk-free rate in rupees. On that, you know, investors would typically add, on average, a 5% rupee depreciation. For the simple reason that if you have inflation differentials like you have in India versus the US dollar or other countries, the rupee has to depreciate. I mean, it can't not. So the fact is that, so they factor in 5%. So you go from 9 to 14. Then you look at the country risk and underlying risk of the country as a whole. That's another 3-4%. So you're up to 17-18. And then you look at the company specific risk, the equity risk, etc. And very quickly you're in the low to mid 20s. And I can guarantee you, however successful companies may be in growing themselves, operating themselves, there are not a lot of companies that can consistently give you 20 to 25% return on equity. They're just not there. And so the whole cost of capital, and this gets back to macro policy, the cost of capital by bringing inflation down is a critical aspect. And you know, the RBI clearly is focused on that by keeping interest rates high. At some point, as inflation does come under control, they'll have to cut interest rates to get the growth going. But till this cost of capital issue is addressed in India, the amount of money coming in, which is needed, and which requires to generate 20 to 25% ROEs, there are not that many projects that can actually do that. You know, the risk is typically globally priced by the bond markets. In India, the bond market doesn't really exist. And that's another big initiative that's been in place for the last 5-10 years. And until you have a more robust insurance, if you look at who invests in long-term bonds, because that's what you really need for infrastructure development and for creating more capital formation. The group is the same group that invests in private equity. I mean, they're the pension plans, the life insurance companies. Again, as you look at them, there's what you call asset liability. Their liabilities are 20, 30, 40 year liabilities. So they want to buy assets which can give them yields for 20, 30, 40 years. Those are the people that invest in long-term debt. And those kind of investors in India, A, don't exist in big numbers, or B, are actually not allowed to invest in long-term debt unless it's a PSU or something. And so as a result, you really have not had a bond market that's developed. This is, again, something that, you know, me and others are spending a lot of time on and trying to figure out how to get a more robust capital market on the bond side, just like there has been, you know, on the FII equity side. And then the relative ease of doing business, like I was saying, you know, if in the big scheme of things, a lot of these multinationals, India is an important country, but a small one, you know, if you are 142 and out of 189 of rank of doing business in India, it just becomes tough to allocate the mind and the time to kind of focus on the country. So I just wanted to, you know, just run through those slides quickly, just to give you a perspective of how do investors look at a country like India, both from a FII perspective and an FDI perspective. Having said that, where are we today? So if you look at, again, 4 months or 5 months or 6 months, I guess, in the context of a country like India is not a long time. But clearly, as you all know, you know, and as you can see from these FII flows, the sentiment right now is dramatically improved. And that too, again, you know, sentiments improve and, you know, go away very quickly. But right now, it's on a high. And what that actually means is that a lot of multinationals, both from an FDI perspective and a portfolio perspective and FII perspective, are spending more time, and as I see it from my clients, more time on looking at India for a longer term investment of size. Now, clearly the government needs to, I mean, there's been a lot of talk, there's been a lot of policy promulgated. There clearly seems to be a very focus, not just on policy, but on execution. You know, it's one thing to say something, it's the other thing to actually get it done. But we'll have to see whether this, you know, the talk, as they say, results in walk the walk, and how that actually gets implemented over a period of time. And in all fairness, you know, to change the ship, to get a lot of these things going, I mean, you know, if you look at the intricacies between central government, state government, local government, how to get all that going, is going to take time. I mean, I don't think you're actually going to see any meaningful investment come in. I know this FII stuff goes in and out, but meaningful investment in foreign direct investment, for example, or on the debt side come in for at least another year or two. People are analyzing, people are looking, people are spending more time and resources to actually do that. But till you see some true movement in government policy, in making things happen, you probably won't see the actual checks being written. The other issue, I think, from a foreign investment perspective, and let's take from a pension plan, you know, one of my clients is a Canadian pension plan, as was said. They have an interesting challenge. So think about this challenge. Essentially, there's one of the few countries in Canada where the pension inflows for now are much higher than the outflows, i.e., you know, what their rule, their law is that 10% of people's income has to go into their pension, 5% from the employee salary and 5% the government the company contributes. So if you look at the inflows that a place like the Canadian pension plan has, they're about $200 billion right now. They have about $15 billion of net inflows, all right? Fresh money coming in because of the pension situation there, and that'll carry on for another 50 years. Second is that they target return is 6% real, basically 4% above the Canadian inflation rate. So if you look at 6% on 20 billion, you know, that's another 12 billion, which is the returns that they're getting every year. So essentially their challenge is an interesting challenge. They have to invest $25 billion every year in addition to whatever other investments are maturing, et cetera. Now that is a hell of a challenge. Actually, if you think about as a portfolio manager sitting in Toronto and with a small an office in London and Hong Kong, to actually invest $25 billion in a sensible, thoughtful manner is an interesting, very, very interesting challenge. So then you say, well, where they then want to put money is where they can do the analysis and write a check of $1 billion. Because ultimately it's what is called, you know, investing at scale. Whether I do the analysis and invest $10 million, I typically have to do the same analysis if I invest $10 million or if I invest $1 billion. So I'll go and invest $1 billion because it helps me meet my objective. Now the problem with the VC industry in India or the PE industry in India is that there are hardly any places where you can, as an LP, even put $100 to $200 million actually as one LP, unless you become half the fund or one of the entire investor in the fund. So the other thing that has to migrate over a period of time is the size of the investment opportunity in India. I mean, it's a big challenge. While we may not think about it that way, I know for a fact that when the Canadian pension plan is looking at making investments in India, they do not want to make any investments that are less than $100 to $200 million because it just does not make economic sense for them from a time allocation and resource allocation perspective. And then you look at how many potential opportunities are there in that context over here, and they're not that many. But having said that, and I'll stop after this because I'd really like to have more of a discussion given how much time we have. I do think that we are at a bit of a cusp. I think it's been said before, but I actually do think it's true. We've got the first time where, you know, you have got both government policy, you've got mindset, and everything else seems to be in the right direction. The ability to actually make things happen because of majority control, et cetera, is there. And I think in the context of global liquidity, there's a lot of global liquidity right now. I mean, just as I said, the CPP is one example. But if you look at banks, you look at other institutions, there's a lot of global liquidity looking to find a sensible home. And so you may have a situation here in the next 2-3 years where you have a fundamental secular shift as to how India has been viewed. I mean, in the big context of things, India is only 70 years old. The reform process is only hardly 20 years old. And so, you know, this is just a blip as to what's happened in the last 4-5 years. But if you look at a secular shift, I think it may be, like you say, you're gearing up. You know, India may just be going gearing up because it's been too small right now. It's been irrelevant from the big scheme of things from a foreign investment perspective. And hopefully you see enough trends going forward and changes going forward that, yeah, we will see more capital. The other thing I also think is that Indian companies are also becoming much more global and international in their thinking, which creates more of a marriage between foreign capital and Indian potential opportunities. So all in all, you know, if you look at India as a global, from a global perspective, interesting country, needs to create 10 million jobs a year, has to be growth, high consumerism, key, some very, very key macroeconomic issues which need to be dealt with, key decision-making issues and political issues which need to be dealt with. But ultimately, I think in the context of the longer term, we should see and we probably will see a lot more investment coming into India, which is obviously very good news. Let me just stop there. And do we have time for questions? Yeah, I'll open up the floor. The first question is always the tough one. Who's going? There you go. Okay.
That was a very nice presentation. Vikram, that was a very nice presentation. You know, you touched upon some very interesting aspects, particularly the international investors coming in here. My question to you is about the prospects for Indian domestic capital.
Yeah.
What's really happening? What is the mindset in India of domestic pension funds, for example, to invest in India? We have it, you know, like you have been successful in bringing some of these Canadian pension funds into India, but our own pension funds are not investing. What's the trend? Are we going to see some change in India?
Well, I really hope we do. I mean, you think about it. I mean, you know, you make the case to foreign investors, whether it be the Californians, the CalPERS, CalSTRS that Professor Tilayarajan mentioned, or the Canadians, or the Norwegians, Dutch. I mean, it's hard to make the case, oh, you should come and invest in India, great opportunity. Oh, but by the way, our pension plans and insurance companies don't do any investment. So it's I do think that needs to change. But I think that's driven a lot by regulation and also the capabilities. I mean, ultimately, if you think at some of these pension plans globally, they are hiring professional money managers who've been in the business for 25, 30 years. Now, you can understand from the point of view maybe of the government or the regulation that if you don't have, I mean, this is pension money, it's got to be, but if you don't have a robust asset management capability, then really kind of allocating, letting resources being allocated to certain asset classes may be risky to do. Having said that, you know, if inflation is at this level, investing in government bonds at 8-9% when inflation at 7 or 8% is not going to create real value over time. I mean, the pensioners basically, if you look at a real value to the pensioners, is going down over a period of time. So I think I do hope, and there's a lot of work going on, as you know, in both the domestic pension legislation, but also for insurance. I mean, LIC and some of the insurance companies, I forget what the percentage is, they can't invest more than a very, very small percent. I think they can't invest in VC at all. I mean, I don't even know. Huh? 3%. Okay, so 3% of the entire life insurance corporation can be invested in some of these asset classes. Well, that's not enough. So I hope, I do hope that happens. I think there's a lot of discussion to it, but there's a lot of resistance too. So we'll have to see how that plays out.
Get, investment opportunities, even at 3%.
Yeah, so that's an unfair point. That's my other point, which is that...
The point is even 3%, they're not able to fulfill.
Yeah.
It's not that, it's not there. It's there, 3% is there, but the total investments are still not able to get to 3%.
Right. On just the VC side, or if
it's
you look
on
at
the
look,
you know, venture capital, and we have allowed them investments in the earlier it was only in the VCs.
Yeah.
Now they good. They are allowed to invest in private equity also.
Yeah.
So, but then the they are still not able to find the.
The in the actual assets the companies to invest in.
So the depth is not there.
The depth, and that's what the foreign investors see too. Though I do think that again, relatively speaking, to if not just pure VC or pure private equity, but I mean, if you talk about taking big strategic positions in companies or, you know, acquisitions, et cetera, there too, the pension plans globally are very, very active because they view that as long-term investment. I just think that over here, you know, if there can be a little more done, it would be, but on the pension side too, I guess, yeah.
I agree. I'm an insurance regulator.
Yeah.
And insurance is a very large investor.
Yeah.
Pension is very small.
Yeah.
The total amount in the pension industry is very, very minuscule. Because so far, it was only a defined contribution.
Correct.
Defined benefit.
Debt benefit, yes.
So it's going to defined contribution. The total assets under management is only 55,000 crores. It's a very small amount. Not even the amount of a medium-sized insurance company.
Yeah.
It has to grow, and it will grow. And I agree with you, pension funds are the message. Then what is your suggestion for improving the corporate bond market?
Well, yeah, so it's actually the corporate bond market, there are two or three things, right? One is that the corporate bond market right now doesn't really exist, partly because of the crowding out by the government, I mean, in a way, in the sense that the government borrowing because of the fiscal deficit is so high that essentially the investor base in the corporate market, bond market, just does not exist. Second is you have to have a yield curve. I mean, and I think that too, apart from the first 5 or 10 years, if you don't develop a yield curve, that's going to be a big problem. And the yield curve, I think, needs to actually be benchmark of a US dollar yield curve. So if you look at some other countries, they've issued some benchmark bonds in US dollars. Now, Indian companies do that, or PSUs have done that, but the actual government has not. So if you create a yield curve, I think that will help a lot. And then I got to ask a question quickly to you, in terms of, for example, LIC, if you did have 30-year paper, would LIC invest actively in that or not? Yeah.
Absolutely.
So,
LIC has liabilities of more than 20, 30
exactly,
years.
Exactly, like a life insurance
and
company.
And they are very hungry for paper beyond 15 years. There is no issue. Even the government doesn't issue debt beyond 15, 20 years. They issue paper for of a 20-year papers, 2,000 crores or 3,000 crores annually, which doesn't satisfy the needs of even LIC.
Yeah.
So there is no issue in the market because there is no other investor who is able to take the other part.
Right.
LIC is hungry for long-term paper.
But only LIC. Yeah. That's part of the problem. So then you can't have a one institution market.
That's the problem.
So that too, you know, in terms of developing the insurance, developing some of the other competitors over a period of time, hopefully will result in a more robust market from the demand side. But I think the first of all, the fiscal deficit needs to come down. And two is, what I'm also hoping is in terms of supply, there's a lot of discussion of these infrastructure projects, right, which are bank funded and then really do need 15, 20 year money. There too, the first thing that we're trying to do is set up these infrastructure funds and then go to the foreign investors for that. And then the foreign investors say, well, we're not getting a proper risk for this return. So then you go back and then there's only LIC. So it's hard to develop a bond market that way. So I think basically you have to develop not only the supply but the investor side, and that will take time. But I think if there's a yield curve developed in US dollars, you'll find foreign investors converting into Indian rupees and investing more longer term money out here. For example, the longer term investors from the US don't really invest in long term debt over here. I mean, they may take some of these short term risks to get a yield, like playing the yield curve, if you will. But they are not investing in long term paper here because they have to price the risk relative to a US dollar based return on Indian paper, and that doesn't exist.
Actually, it's the lack of a derivative market.
That's also true.
They are not able to hedge their interest rate risk.
Exactly.
Countries like China, Brazil, and Indonesia, the growth and the perspective of the general LPs and all the FDIs is very positive, and they are growing exponentially. What is it? Why do investors look at these countries in a very different perspective vis-a-vis India? In context of the other points which you may not have highlighted in your presentation here. For example, Indonesia, from where I see, is a very huge tourism hub. So there must be some foreign direct investment going in that, where they are actually encashing it and they are growing at a very fast rate. India also has a lot of capability apart from manufacturing. There are other sectors which are still unexplored. And a lot of foreign direct investment coming in these sectors can enhance the economy of the nation. So could you throw some light on this?
I think I was just trying to give you a relative basis in terms of, you know, what percentage, how has FDI changed in the last 4 or 5 years in those countries, and what the percentage of FDIs to GDP. Don't get me wrong, I mean, those countries also have their own issues. And so it's not, you know, that everything is golden there and everything is messed up over here. I think just on a relative basis, my point was that there's a lot of scope for more. Now, why is there more money, say, going into Brazil, for example? It's just a lot of foreign direct investment coming from North America. They just find it easier to deal with Brazil because it's in the same time zone. They just go fly back up and north, and it's just easier from that perspective. The ease of doing business has been strong, and to the earlier point, the hedging market to hedge currency risk and all that is just much more robust. So as a result, there are a lot of little factors that play into it. To your point, I think tourism in India is a completely, you know, it's a hidden gem. It should be. I mean, it's just completely unexploited. But you need the right infrastructure for it. You need the right policies for it. You need the right kind of investment for it. So I do think that, you know, India and China, while, again, the numbers are very large, a lot of China FDI actually is from the Chinese, from North America, putting money back into China, which doesn't really happen. It's happening a little bit in India, but nowhere close to what happens in China. So I think each one of them has their pros and cons in terms of these countries, but I just do think that for the size of this economy, the ease of doing business is actually the single most important factor. I mean, while returns are, you know, people factor it in, they haven't been that good, etc. But ease of doing business and changing perspectives on policy. For example, while you may think that it's not such a big deal, but that one, you know, I don't know whether you remember, a couple of years ago, there was this, they implemented certain tax thing about GAR and Vodafone and want to go back and forth. Now, if you think about it again, there's the, as you know, I think Nokia shut down over here somewhere because some tax thing.
There has been this whole issue of British Petroleum, where they suddenly slapped on a huge transfer tax on them just out of the blue. A lot of that may be legitimate, but the fact is it is a change of policy. And it's a glaring change of policy, at least on the part of how foreign investors view it. So you get back to the whole issue of, is this worth it? And so I think if what my point really was, that the scope of actually just coming on par with some of these other countries in terms of size and percent of GDP will bring in nearly double or triple the amount of FDI that actually has come in. And I think the ease of doing business and consistency in policy is absolutely critical. I mean, like anything, if you did something and the rules of the game changed on you in the middle of it all, it'll be hard to actually justify spending more time on it. And I think that's been a consistent problem in India over the years. And hopefully that people have learned from that and won't happen in the future. I'm sorry? Yeah, I think from a pure foreign investor perspective, probably not. Because for the simple reason, the foreign investors will look at the project or the company on a standalone basis, or investing in a stock or a bond pretty much on a standalone basis, keeping in mind the macro story and all. But I do think that if you look at the needs of investment in India, bringing in all the hidden economy into the mainstream is critical, absolutely critical. And I think, again, people recognize that. People are talking a lot about bringing in the black money, converting it, raising the tax net. I mean, people talk, for example, again, the change of policy, for example, that's an issue. But if you truly look at India's tax rates, they are very competitive globally. You know, the Indian tax rates are extremely competitive. If you live in New York as an individual, you end up paying 50% plus in income taxes. Okay, so India's tax rate actually is very competitive. But there are not enough people who pay taxes who should. And that's part of the issue, is actually bringing in that in tax compliance and tax enforcement in a, what I guess the new government calls in a consumer-friendly manner. whatever that means, is actually very, very important. The other thing which I think is a big policy initiative is trying to move assets away from dead assets like gold to more active assets like financial institutions, financial instruments. There's too much of the economy in gold and real estate and not in active, financial investments. And that too, again, if you see more of that in mutual funds grow much more than they should, then you'll see more institutional investors along with LIC who can actually make a market, because otherwise there's nobody else to actually make a market. Yes.
Yeah. So you spoke about soft capital in a part of your presentation. So I myself interned at an investment bank, a foreign investment bank in India. So a lot of the work here is support services.
Yeah.
And most of the front office is, as you may know, in New York, in Shanghai, in Sao Paulo. So, well, and you spoke about increasing or rather training more people to get enough skills to work in more skilled jobs. So how would you say, what would you suggest measures to bring in better quality jobs as opposed to just BPOs and support services, not just in the investment banking sector, but all over?
Well, I think I'm not too sure. Well, if you just look at pure numbers, I agree with you that, a lot of the big investment banks and even consulting firms, if you just look at the number of employees, yes, more will be in the so-called back office. But I think a lot of the front office stuff happens in India too now. I mean, the actual investment bankers, the traders, all, and a lot of them sit in Mumbai as opposed to flying in and out. Now, there'll obviously be some people that fly in and out. I do think that when I say, if you look at where the jobs need to be created, while there are the high-end kind of super intellectual jobs where all the IIT grads go, there are at least 10 times the more number of jobs that need to be created at the vocational level. So I think the bigger challenge actually is, in my view, is creating more of the, not the BPO kind of jobs, but the vocational jobs, because that's like the construction and infrastructure and manufacturing. And you'll find, well, we were talking before a little bit about affordable housing and some of the discussions I had before I came here, that you have a country where you basically supposedly have a surplus of human capital, right? But at the same time, actually, if you talk to most developers and construction, people in the construction industry, there is a complete shortage of labor. People who can actually perform the job that they're supposed to perform. So you have this complete disconnect where you have in terms of sheer numbers, but you don't have the people that are trained to perform the job. So I think a big, and that, you know, for example, the NSDC and other things that have been set up to promote that is very important. But I do think there's a big gap between the skill level of the people and the job requirements. So I do think the high-end jobs, I think, will come to India over a period. As it just becomes a larger economy, a more important economy, more and more people will move their kind of so-called front office jobs here. But in my view, front office jobs in the services sector is not going to move the needle in terms of the employment growth that we need. It's going to be much more at the middle level, lower end jobs at manufacturing and infrastructure, which soak in a lot of employment, and training and guiding and building that capability actually is quite critical.
We have time for one last question.
Where is this hidden question?
Taking the time to answer all the questions. So I think we see a lot of information on FDI inflows and investments. Strictly speaking, from a private equity standpoint, you seldom hear about exits.
Yeah.
And in the last couple of years, you know, we've not had too many blockbuster exits. Probably Redbus was a good one. And probably the milk company is a good one. And the microfinance was good when it listed, but then, you know, you all know the story.
Mm.
So how do LPs perceive this, you know, this particular situation where there's a skew in terms of money going to specific sectors, for instance, e-commerce, but not so much into critical sectors like water, sanitation, or agriculture as such. And even it seems like the fund managers take a long time to even raise their money. So they seem to be more spending more time on the road raising money.
Yeah.
Probably this is, I'm not sure if this is something post 2008. So any comments on that?
Yeah. So I think in terms of exits, obviously, you know, ultimately you only get a return when you exit. And I think part of the problem with India with the exits has been is the IPO market and the equity markets basically have been shut for the last 2-3 years for all the issues, that reasons I mentioned, you know, all the bigger macro issues, the policy issues, et cetera. There really have been no public market exits. I'm hopeful, and you see a lot more pipeline developing right now of good companies coming to market where there is an actual robust market to make that happen. So I do think you probably see more exits going forward. But, you know, that is the one of the reasons why a lot of capital doesn't come in. I mean, that's because of things like, just like you said. Therefore, what do people do when the private equity industry, and I don't see that changing too much in the near term anyway, is by, you know, finding good companies that are already public and taking significant stakes in them. And if you look at the ones that may, if you just, while each PE firm may be unique and better, good, but if you invested in vintage, you know, vintage of year of investment is really critical. So if you invested in a PE fund or a PE fund invested in India between 2002 and 2004 and exited 3-4 years later, you made a killing. If you invested in 2006, 2007, you're still holding the bag at a really underwater portfolio. So I think that's one thing. Second is, you know, to your point about e-commerce and versus water and sanitation, the fact is capital will go where there is a belief that the risk-adjusted return of that capital is there. And right now, there's a lot of view that, you know, India's consumer boom, like I mentioned, the fact is that the infrastructure around e-commerce is building, the last mile issues are developing, the payment systems in terms of, you know, card payments and the payment systems that support e-commerce are developing, the potential infrastructure that goes with all the logistics that happen with e-commerce. So anyway, now whether that's right or wrong, and ultimately, while everyone can believe the e-commerce is hot, the question really we'll have to see 4-5 years later is whether the incoming valuations, which right now seem to be pretty robust, would be an understatement, kind of pan out. And I think people are, you know, people are looking at Alibaba and everything else and saying, oh my God, if you invested in Alibaba, you know, 4 years ago and what you did today, would be just phenomenal. And a lot of the benchmark is going on around that. Now on water, sanitation, et cetera, I just don't think right now there have been enough businesses that can attract true private capital because, you know, it's those are what I would call not utilities, but there's a lot of public and there's a lot of work going on here at the university, my belief is, on water, for example. There's a big element of public support. So it's like saying, you know, even though some roads have been gone private, can every road really be a private venture? No. because it'll never generate the return. It's a public provision rather from public money. So I do think that ultimately, you know, where there is a good risk-adjusted return, given the macro situation, you'll find capital. Where there is not, you won't. And I think that's really what drives the differential between the two. But again, like I said, if you look at, you know, the bigger picture long-term, my hope is that a lot of those things that you mentioned change. I do also think that the other thing which has changed for the benefit of private equity is that till, say, quite recently, any kind of company had access to the public markets. You know, so the actual vigilance in terms of diligence, the regulatory, the transparency, the reporting was much less required, and therefore a lot of companies which probably should not have gone public went public. And as a result, they didn't need private equity, they didn't need private capital. So you may see more supply of interesting companies that you know, previously could have gone public, etc. Anyway, that's all right. Well, thank you again very much for having me here. As I said, I've never not been to the IIT campus before. You have a gorgeous campus over here. I wish I had studied here. but thank you very much, and you know, good luck to all of you in all your future careers. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. In the interest of time, we now have to end the question and answer session. Guests will be able to interact with the speaker during the networking session that follows. We are now approaching the end of today's session. I request the chief guest, director, and head of the department to take the seat on the dais. I now request the director to felicitate our chief guest with a memento.
I request the audience to kindly be seated for a few more moments, please.
This year's report has had the benefit of very eminent advisory board. Some of the advisory board members are here with us today, and we are thankful that they are here amidst their busy schedule. I now request the director to felicitate them with a memento. Mr. Arvind Mathur, President, Indian Private Equity and Venture Capital Association. Mr. R.K. Nair, Member, Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority. Mr. Sandeep Reddy, Managing Director, People Capital. I now request Professor T.J. Kamal Nabhan to felicitate the director with a memento. For many of us, summer was a period of 2 months, but for so much, the past summer turned out to be the longest ever and lasted for the whole of 6 months. He started working on this year's report for his summer internship and has continued to work till this date. I request Sumaj Bandopadhyay, a second year MBA student at IIT Madras, to deliver his vote of thanks.
Honorable Director of IIT Madras, Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, a chief guest, Sri Vikram Gandhi, Head of the Department of Management Studies, Professor T.J. Kamal Nabhan, guests from the industry, esteemed faculty members of IIT Madras, and my friends and fellow students. We have come to the end of a delightful evening, and it is my privilege to propose a vote of thanks. Feeling good about something but not expressing a heartfelt thank you is like wrapping a gift for someone but never giving it to them. Now, of course, I have no intention of doing so. So I'd like to take the opportunity to thank a chief guest for the evening, Sri Vikram Gandhi, for delivering an exceptional speech on the topic Investing in India, a Perspective from Wall Street and Main Street. I'm sure that everyone present in the hall has been inspired by your great words, sir. You literally straddle multiple time zones, and we do not have enough words to thank you for having accepted a request to be a part of this event, taking time out of your busy schedule. I would like to thank the advisory board of this year's report. We were extremely fortunate to have an advisory board that comprised of Sri Gopal Srinivasan, the founder, chairman and MD of TVS Capital, Sri R.K. Nair, member of IRDA, Sri Sandeep Reddy, co-founder and MD of People Capital, Sri Anup Bagchi, MD and CEO of ICICI Securities, Sri Arvind P. Mathur, the president of IVCA, without whom the report might have failed to see daylight. Such an extensive work does not end in a day. It takes months of toil. I'd like to thank the entire advisory board of the report for extending the help towards us every possible way, from helping us to focus on the right themes of the report, to sharpening the messages and finally reviewing the draft of the report. I'd also like to thank all the main contributors of this year's report, Professor G. Sabarinathan, Faculty of Finance, IIM Bangalore, Arumugam A., the former Managing Director of JRE Partners and presently an independent investor and advisor, Professor Ashok Junjunwala, Professor of IIT Madras, where he also leads the Telecommunication and Computer Networks Group, Dr. Tamaswati Ghosh, the officer in charge of IIT Madras Incubation Cell, the Nodal Body for Entrepreneurship-related Activities at IIT Madras, Suma Prashant, the Director of IIT Madras Rural Technology and Business Incubator, and Dr. Suraj Srinivasan, Senior Research Associate at IFMR. They have shared their valuable knowledge with us through the report, and we thank them for that. I take this opportunity to thank Professor Bhaskar Ramamurthy, the Director of IIT Madras, Professor T.J. Kamalanabhan, the Head of the Department of Management Studies, for the constant support that they have shown towards the report. It would have been difficult to go ahead with the project without your help and encouragement. Thank you, sir. Also express my sincere gratitude to the International Alumni Office of IIT Madras, who has continued to provide financial support for this publication. I also express my gratitude to the Central Lecture Theatre Office, Department of Management Studies Office, Institute Administration and the Horticulture Wing for helping us wholeheartedly to organize the event and the team which has actually made this evening an evening to remember, the Extramural Lecture Series team. Before concluding, I'd like to thank all those who are here today despite the wet weather. We are very fortunate to have such a distinguished audience for the event today. For the first time in 6 years during the report release, we had the rain god making his visit. Rain indicates prosperity, as we all know, and I hope the forthcoming year would be a year of prosperity for all of us. I'm sure that all of you have found the session interesting and will go back with little more knowledge than you had when you stepped into the hall. I'd like to conclude by quoting William Shakespeare, "Ignorance is the curse of God, knowledge is the wing through which we fly to heaven." I'm sure the knowledge that you've gathered through this event will help you in the days to come. Thank you.
Thank you so much. May I request the speaker to scribble a few words and sign the EML yearbook. I would like to close this event by quoting P.T. Barman, "Money is good for nothing unless you know the value of it by experience." I hope you all have had a great experience here. The session is now over and the forum is open for interaction. I request all the guests to stay back and join for refreshments at Hall 133 outside the auditorium. The students may collect it as they go. Thank you.